Okay, everyone, it's time to drink the Kool-Aid. Not a whole lot of it, just a bit, but today I want to go down a rabbit hole and weave together a narrative based off of some very interesting articles, leaks, events, and posts that I've spent the past day or so exploring. Here is a necessary disclaimer, though. This video isn't 100% serious. It's more of a what if. Some of the information I cover today has been discussed before, some has been partially disproven, debunked, or called into question to varying different degrees, and this video is less of a here is the truth about Anthem and more of a here is the truth about the games industry trends. Here is a bunch of crazy interesting stuff that seems to fit extremely well within Anthem. It would be a shame not to talk about it. So without further ado, come with me down the rabbit hole as we talk about the Anthem conspiracy. Gaming has a lot of anti-consumer trends and normative behavior nowadays. A good place to start that has also been hashed and rehashed time and time again is loot boxes. The idea of randomizing rewards to prey specifically on a vulnerable few, or whales, who make the system highly profitable. The more important step that has been taken, however, beyond the simple sale of randomized rewards is public opening procedures, or POP for short. Public opening procedures are, to the very letter, a psychological manipulation tactic to incentivize players through jealousy. Now, keep that in mind specifically because we will be talking in depth about psychological manipulation and jealousy later in the video. Now, to be clear, not all games have done this or taken that step. A good one to harken back to, though, is Call of Duty World War II, with very public opening crate animations. The idea is that you see another player getting cool things right in front of you, and you could get those things too. All you have to do is pay real money. This type of manipulation extends further, however. The same parent publisher who owns Call of Duty, that is Activision Blizzard, holds a system patent which specifically alters game matchmaking to incentivize microtransaction purchases. For the sake of time, I will summarize, but it is a very interesting read and I will link it down below. The basic overview is that the system will alter matchmaking on a per-user basis to further spur real-world purchases. If a player likes sniping or frequently uses a sniper rifle, that player may be matched with an enemy combatant who uses a high-powered purchasable sniper rifle, at which point they will be beaten and publicly shown that their enemy is using that rifle, which may cause them to go buy it. The whole concept is predation to a new degree. Specific quotes like, "this may encourage the player to make future purchases to achieve similar gameplay results," are littered across the page, and the various graphs show a malignant tumor of a system that is built to prey on their player base at the expense of user experience. It is psychological manipulation with an emphasis on jealousy and doctored matchmaking results. An Activision spokesperson did a bit of PR damage control back when they first broke the story and claimed that the system was just some R&D exploratory stuff done by an unconnected third-party company. They also claimed it does not exist in any of their games, but the truth is that they hold this patent. They do. That's categorically proven. They went out and created this concept, and now they own it. Some viewers may be wondering how this relates to Anthem, and right now, it doesn't, but bear with me. Switching gears, let's discuss EA. EA is, after all, the publisher behind Anthem and has an even deeper relationship with psychological manipulation tactics than Activision Blizzard. Not only is CEO Andrew Wilson, CEO of EA, by the way, the driving force behind the modern-day loot box, as we know and hate them, they are also the main reason the loot box phenomenon received any regulation whatsoever. Through unmitigated greed, EA designed a system of pure gambling-based progression in their early version of Star Wars Battlefront II. The system relied on crate-based star cards to rank up player power, and there was also an always-visible kill card upon death showing the cards your enemy employed to defeat you. At its core, this was two important things. Number one, blatant pay to win, since the rest of the game's systems were designed to throttle the players, and for those that don't know, I have done a whole video on that topic. Throttling is the act of forcefully slowing down a player's rewards or experience gain to try and corral them into purchasing microtransactions as a fix for that. The Star Wars Battlefront II system was throttled to an unbelievable degree. Credits from arcade mode were capped, dozens of hours of grinding were needed just to get a single hero that many players obviously wished to play, since the game is, after all, part of the beloved Star Wars universe. And overall, the system was the most egregious version of pay-to-win seen in a major AAA title possibly ever. The second thing the system was, and arguably more important for our descriptive purposes here today, was psychological manipulation. The idea that players who spent a bunch of real money on gambling crates would have their star cards publicly visible on every kill, which would further spur their enemies to purchase crates to catch up. It is a system designed to prey on jealousy, frustration, and manipulate their core player base into forking over extra money to enjoy a game they already paid full price for. Now, the systems have been changed. EA was hit by a wave of backlash that reverberates through the gaming space to this very day, and probably isn't dissipating anytime soon. So yes, the game's system was changed somewhat, but this is to establish a baseline. EA is a company that is perfectly fine with injecting manipulative systems into their games. There is zero hesitation there. Now that some groundwork is laid out and a sort of background has been established, let's talk about AI in video games. AI, or artificial intelligence, isn't quite as glorious as the sci-fi movies just yet, but it is still rather formidable. The idea behind AI right now is that it will tackle specific problems with autonomous freedom to make decisions in order to meet an end result or goal. It's not some wide-reaching full autonomy concept, not yet at least not in video games, but within the confines of a given task, it will make its own decisions and learn. Not too long ago, a document leaked, and there's air quotes around a document there for reasons that I'll go into more specifically later on, which outlined a proposed concept for the use of AI in gaming to further spur user purchasing habits. Here's where we need some clarification, though. The document is pretty wild. Personally, I don't think it's real in the sense that it's a fully accurate representation of a system that was actively developed, finished, or will ever be implemented in anything on a one-to-one basis. It's got quite a few typos that really shouldn't be there. It's been picked apart a bit by some users over on Reddit and 4chan who are more well-versed in some of the technical language than I am overall, and some of the proposed items in the slides are, well, they just require a bit too much Kool-Aid. But if we reframe and think about this system within the construct of what has already been proven to exist within the gaming industry, suddenly a lot more of it becomes a lot more plausible. For research purposes, I'll link to absolutely everything that I was reading regarding this topic down below in the description for anyone that wants to dig through all of that, just FYI. Here is an overview of the presentation slides that were leaked. Names and certain paragraphs have been redacted, but we can very clearly see some screenshots that obviously come from Anthem and are based off of the game's original promotional material. The main purpose of the presentation seems to be the explanation of new AI systems that would pose as players in certain scenarios and create a dynamic gaming environment with user-based profiles developed to help the AI program manipulate players on an individual level. There is a lot more in the documents as well. There is a 3D mapping system outlined to help build profile information based on home layout. There is even a section about identifying whether a player is male or female, and then using voice analytics and other feedback to find out the menstrual cycle if the user is female, because behavior and shopping habits can also change through emotional state, and the program would use that information to construct a dynamic, incentivized gameplay experience wherein the user would pay more during that time span. It's pretty wild, and honestly, I don't believe all of it. Not even close. But for the purpose of this video, I'll focus in on the stuff that I honestly do believe. To be clear, I don't believe that it is necessarily in Anthem in the same way, but I believe it's something the industry either already has in some capacity or is actively working on, and it's pretty obvious that some of the major publishers are totally fine with implementing it. That's a given at this point. Here is a main slide which offers a pretty good summary. The big three ideas. Number one, by utilizing artificial intelligence, or AI, it's possible to increase revenue streams in-game by combining out-of-game or real-life information and out-of-game AI-generated activities with in-game premium activities. Number two, our main revenue creation tactic for all our clients involves utilizing persistent bait and switching of in-game incentive advertisements with intermittent premium advertisements driven by the same AI. Number three, most importantly, we have proven that allowing the AI to alter a player's game as a whole, social engineering, and alter the player's individual gameplay experience, psychological manipulation tactics, causes a consistent and dramatic increase in recurrent revenue streams. What we see there is, again, the specific concept of psychological manipulation. Now, it's oddly blatant here. Corporate snake speak is usually a lot more veiled, which builds up my skepticism further. But we're drinking the Kool-Aid, so let's not stop now. There's more to get through. The next slides offer up an example of bad advertisements and good advertisements, while the slides shown are quite obviously Anthem. The thing is, these ads do not exist in Anthem in any capacity whatsoever, so we can realistically establish that this is not a one-to-one implementation, if any of it was implemented at all, that is. The reason it is relevant, though, is because of the current circumstances surrounding Anthem's combat, loot, damage scaling, and a few other indicators or factors, but I will cycle back to that in a minute here. The next slide that is particularly relevant is this one, 2A, flat rates are applied to linear reward systems. The problem that currently seems impossible to solve is fixed price points. Around the year 2500 BC in ancient Egypt, merchants started listing prices in their stores for goods that they sold. Before, whenever a customer walked in, a customer would ask for a price on a good and be given the price on the spot. Afterwards, tablets were used to denote prices and offer the same price on items to all customers. For over 4,500 years, we've been using the same method, but with newer and newer tablets. It's time to disrupt the shopping space. Outlined in Schedule C, you'll find how we plan to create new price points for goods that have a fixed manufacturing cost regardless of the lack of any replication costs. Previous dynamic pricing models caused backlash because customers viewed selectively increased charges as unfair. Our models go under people's radar by disguising dynamic prices as rewards instead of indirect taxations. The example given seems a bit odd and not very eloquent, to say the least, but the idea of flat rates on linear reward systems is pretty accurate. The language is a bit confusing, but the desire to subvert user backlash by having an adjustment system slide under the radar that increases per user profits and price points is something that is well within the world of not only possibility, but high probability. As a side note, here's a great example. CEO Strauss Zelnick of Take-Two Interactive has specifically said with the exact same language that they feel they are under-monetizing on a per-user basis. So this whole concept starts to go from highly speculative and probably not true or something that you turn your nose up at and think no way, to something that really seems like it fits well within the overarching narrative of the games industry. Now, I'm going to skip through a lot of the different slides because some of the material just isn't relevant to our topic today, and there is a lot of it to say the very least. But the next slide that is worth talking about is this one. This is a graph of the proposed AI system progressing through its stages. It starts with a user profile with various details extrapolated from the other active systems outlined in the document, and then begins the process. The most important factor here is that the AI has determined keyword characteristics for the player based on susceptibility. In this case, envy, frustration, and uncertainty. The player seems to be a bit hot-tempered, is skeptical of rewards, and displays envy towards other players. First, it starts the strategy, but then it introduces an AFE, or artificial frustration event. Now, from existing systems already patented within the industry, we know that an example of that could easily be matching the player with a higher skilled opponent, specifically using a better version of the gun they themselves prefer. This builds frustration as the better player kills you over and over with the very item that you want. AFE, or artificial frustration events, are not some wild conspiracy. They may be all too real. If not now, then very soon. If the event fails or is non-optimal, the AI will exit the loop and find a new revenue tactic. But if the event is successful, we move on to the next phase of monitored frustration. This is where things get really interesting. Based on a subject's frustration level, the AI cycles to one of two options. Either uncertainty, in which it presents a reward with a greater promised reward the following day for logging in, or envy, with the new preset AJE, or artificial jealousy event. In the jealousy event, the AI would present itself as a human player. This part confuses me a lot because it's unclear what possible purpose the pretense of humanity would hold. This could easily all be an automated process. There is no necessity for human presentation, but whatever, moving on. The player then reaches the desired conclusion and either buys a product, whatever product it is that they were presented through the two events, and is then redirected back into the process to the uncertainty angle, and the steps conclude, or alternatively, the player does not buy the product and is fed back into step one, where they once again cycle through all of the different events. The AI is described as using all user input to determine key information. As an example of this, the clever indicators slide outlines how gathering user key presses and tracking mouse speed can show frustration levels and determine active or passive play. Desktop. Our suite of tools actually includes more points of interest for desktop than for mobile. Although different data is captured, users are more engaged on desktop and we get more information on mouse positions, speed, and variations therein. This changes how we detect the same things as we would have on mobile. There is also a much more concentrated stream of input and key presses from a desktop user. We use key presses for indicators of engagement and frustration. A user that stops pressing keys and waits for a game trigger after a frustration event is likely playing passively. An example of what the AI can do is detect when it presents a frustration event, such as an unfair death for the player avatar, and then monitor the keyboard activity and in-game activity afterwards. If the player continues to press keys that would have no effect in rapid succession after the frustration effect, they are likely becoming frustrated. If the frustration dissipates within 2 seconds, they are somewhat sensitive to gameplay advantage adds. Anyone who experiences over 2 seconds of frustration after the artificial frustration event is very likely to pay higher prices on top of being susceptible to premium adds. The AI will then alter gameplay to introduce more artificial frustration events in order to increase revenue. There are also longer descriptions of complex crafting pathways used to sell microtransactions and adaptive parameters to pivot to high scores tracking if the player begins to check leaderboards frequently. If it is determined the player wishes to climb said leaderboards, a whole new event pathway opens up yet again, in which the player is sold relevant options to achieve that goal with scripted incentive events alongside. All of this is very interesting to me, but again, we reach the moment where viewers may wonder what this has to do with Anthem. So here goes. A Reddit user by the name AZAnimeFan posted a long thread which outlined a bit of his own speculation regarding this very topic, and also cited quite a few of the relevant articles I am also linking to. Within the post, there was also a link found and cited by another user named DNGIOVA, not sure how to pronounce that, and the link displays a verified patent held by EA which pertains to the incentive programs and implementations designed to keep users logging in each day into their online profiles. Now, this patent is actually much more than that, and it's long. It is extremely long. If I go into the specifics, the video will end up being like over 3 hours, but the patent pertains to a lot of the same material that is outlined in the leaked slides. It goes into detail about how to psychologically manipulate users who operate the in-game shop through scripted sales events and other pointedly designed tactics. It, of course, never uses the words psychological manipulation, but the effect is the same regardless of specific verbiage. Then, though this is far from any sort of concrete evidence, we can clearly see that the patent was finalized February 12, 2019, which is mere days before Anthem's launch, and also likely means that there was a pending period, patent pending, active long before that. Now let's consider the checkered past Anthem has already shown since launch. The damage scaling and displayed damage indicators can be complete fabrication at times. There are instances where damage numbers increase, but relative damage goes down. Upward scaling on components that punishes players for equipping all their highest level gear, but rewards them for slotting level 1 components in certain instances, and a whole host of other problems which are seemingly never ending and constantly evolving. Players have been begging for loot changes since the very beginning, specifically to generosity in a positive way, and when one finally comes along that buffs drop rates and increases overall player enjoyment in the tens of thousands of players, by the way, BioWare immediately asserts that it was an unintentional bug and rolls back the change in a heartbeat. This results in a literal boycott. You would think that that could sway the development team, but again, no dice. Every consecutive Anthem update, especially pertaining to loot and damage scaling, has been further removed from the realm of reason, or so it seems. To highlight a specific paragraph in another thread by a user named Temperhoof, who spent days doing all the different math, and it's an excellent document, by the way, has all of the articulated proof to back up his claims, etc., he talks about the arbitrary multiplier. The arbitrary multiplier is a calculation which turns the game into a complex dance between actual power level and power scaling, and effectively creates a world of constant diminishing returns where players are in a perpetual state of being punished by Anthem rather than rewarded for the gear that they have been able to grind and acquire. The ending paragraph perfectly summarizes the key issue, though I would recommend reading all of it for anyone who's interested. It ties this entire video together. This isn't some sort of bug, he says. This is a fundamental design flaw. At this point, the game is lying to you about how much damage you are doing. This is why there is no stat sheet, as there isn't anything worth recording. If you play the game thinking your power scores, weapons, abilities, components, or the inscriptions attached to them matter, then you're doing yourself harm. Follow my advice, realize that as of 1.0.3, none of it matters anymore, and just become melee and ultimate spamming gods. The problems with Anthem run deep, and there's much more that I could talk about, but now I ask all of you conspiracy theorists out there, is it possible that Anthem has utilized some new age dynamic scaling and per user rewards AI system? Is it possible that the reason the game is struggling so badly, and it appears that BioWare is ignoring player frustration and loot requests specifically, is because on a fundamental level, they aren't in total control? Is it possible that Anthem is using a freshly constructed system to learn and manipulate the game's infrastructure with the goal of teaching a fledgling AI program how best to operate, and that it's just going badly right now? Because it is, after all, a fresh concept, and they are not even close to perfecting it. Is it possible? It is CEO Andrew Wilson, after all, a man notably saying players who spend more money have more fun. Psychological manipulation exists in video games, systems designed to play on user fear of missing out, jealousy, greed, and so much more. The idea of having a scalable, dynamic program at the helm which alters the gameplay for individuals in such a way as to spur further purchases, to me, is not just believable, it is highly likely. Now though, for a bit of honesty on my end, I don't believe the leaked slides are real in the sense of an actual corporate document that was ever legitimately used. It reads more like a clever college kid did a project about a dystopian video game future or something like that. But the sad truth is that even in such an overboard way, a lot of it is not just possible, it is, frankly, probable. Some is certainly overboard, illegal, and pretty much all of it is unethical. But despite the leaked document being most likely just a social experiment or an amateur thought provocation assignment, it makes just enough sense to get the mind racing. We know for a fact companies like EA and Activision Blizzard experiment with psychological manipulation. They've done so numerous times in the past and they'll continue to do it, to the design of further increasing player spending. We have trackable patents by both companies to that very specific end. It's a constant dance of what can we get away with, and in such a world, would it not be naive to think that EA wouldn't try out a new AI program designed to feed users frustration events, or AFEs, or AJEs, or alter their in-game experience without their knowledge? Who knows? But this whole project has been so interesting, I just had to make a video on it. There it is. We went down the rabbit hole and posed the question of whether or not Anthem is the first step down a road of secretly altered gaming experiences. Honestly, probably not. But would I believe it if proven? Yeah, I think I would. But take this whole video with a grain of salt, a big grain of salt, by the way. It's fun to speculate. It's fun to get wrapped up in the process, but we should all keep our feet on the ground and maintain healthy skepticism rather than truly diving off the deep end. That's it though. That was honestly a really fun one. Thank you everyone who made it this far. Hopefully it was just as fun for you all to listen to as it was for me to write and make. But yeah, enough is enough. If you want to support the channel, check out the links down below. We have gaming communities, merchandise, and some other stuff too, but I'll cut it there and I'll stop rambling. Thank you all for watching and have a nice night.